Good evening, and welcome to day three of our online neurology days. I'm Erin Beveridge, clinical researcher, and on behalf of Canon, I'm delighted to bring you this third and final session focused on the stroke patient pathway. I'm very excited about this evening. Not only is the topic of interventional treatment the biggest thing to have advanced stroke care in recent years, but we also have a fantastic panel of speakers from across the globe lined up this evening who are going to take us into the angio suite with them to bring this topic to life. It is therefore my privilege to introduce you to our moderator for the evening, Dr. Gonzalez Mandley, who's joining us from Spain. Dr. Gonzalez Mandley took a residency in radiology from 1996 to 2000 in the University Hospital Marquez de Valdecia, where he also went on to specialise in interventional neuroradiology. Since then, he has become chief of the Department of Radiology, where he also continues to practice as a neurointerventionalist, with a special interest in AVM, medullary intervention, and stroke. And with that, I give the word to you, Dr. Gonzalez Mandley.
So thank you very much, and welcome to this webinar. It is an honor for me to be able to present today these two prominent speakers. First of all, we will have the presentation by Dr. Nevia Caputo, and then the presentation by Professor Adnan Siddiqui. And at the end of the presentations, we will have a short or long, if you want, session of questions and answers. I would like to present, I am very honored to present Dr. Nevia Caputo. She is currently the Director of Radiology of the Azienda Sanitaria Locale in the city of Teramo in Italy. As a neuroradiologist, her main area of expertise is interventional neuroradiology, but she has also broad experience in the fields of CT and MRI of neurological conditions. She has worked in many places, and among them the Lisholm Radiological Department of the National Hospital for Neurology and Neurosurgery of London. As an investigator, she has participated in well-known studies, and she has published over 100 articles that prove her expertise in the field of neurointerventional radiology. The title of her presentation is The Role of Endovascular Neuroradiology in the Neurological and Neurosurgical Emergencies. Dr. Caputo, we are really looking forward to learning from your experience, so let's get started.
Okay, thank you. Good evening, everybody. As Dr. Gonzalez said, I'm speaking from Italy and from a city called Teramo. This is the hospital where I'm currently working and from where now I'm speaking. In this relation, I'm going to present four cases of intracranial aneurysms in which we had some technical problems, and I'll tell you how we dealt with them and how we got over them. So, well, first case is about men, 36 year old, with small left M1, M2 aneurysms detected on MRI, done because he had 7 days before the admission to the hospital, headache and neck stiffness. The patient underwent angiography, and so we confirmed the presence of the aneurysm, and we saw also an irregular shape of the lesion with the bleb on its dome, with the lesion had a quite large neck connected to the superior branch of the middle cerebral artery. Patient underwent surgery. And a few days later, in the post-op announced CT, we saw a round vascular image next to the surgical clip. So we repeated the arteriography, and we saw that the aneurysm was still there, probably because the clip has slipped away from its original position. But at that time, had also changed the shape, because neck now was quite narrow. So it could have been occluded with coils. Well, the problem was that to find the best way to visualize the neck of the aneurysm, avoiding the surgical clip, in order to have to get safe access to the aneurysm and to spare the parent vessel. Well, we did the rotational angiography and reconstructed 3D images, which we selected the last one, in which the neck of the lesion is nicely seen, visualized, But you see, it wasn't possible for the equipment. Well, nevertheless, with some little adjustments of the bed position and of the biplane C-arms, we could get the corresponding view to the aneurysm, corresponding to the selected view, and with the floor-mounted C-arm, and the opposite with the ceiling-mounted C-arm. Well, no problems to get to the aneurysm and to fill it with some coils. And this was the final result with all the intracranial left circulation good and with no more visible the aneurysm. Well, let's move to the other case. It's a ruptured aneurysm of the anterior communicating artery in a male, 56 years, with a history of migraine and hypertension. He had a severe sudden headache followed by comatose state 3 hours before the admission to the hospital. Well, on plain CT, you can see the blood into basal and cortical systems. And after contrast medium, on reconstructed CT images, you can appreciate the irregular bizarre shape of the lesion. The patient underwent the angiographic examination, injecting the left side, left internal carotid artery. We see again the aneurysm with very bizarre shape. We see also both of each segments coming from the left side because there was no A1 segment in the right side. We could also see both of the posterior cerebral arteries coming from the anterior circulation. Well, we did the rotational angiography and the 3D images. We realized that we are very phasing with three aneurysms. Two of them, large in size, had a common neck constituting the anterior communicating artery. The smallest one, with a larger neck, was related to the A2 right segment. So we knew we needed a flow diverter to reconstruct the neck of the aneurysms. We knew also that we needed some coils to protect the lesion, but stent gelling technique was not feasible. So we had to find the correct views to insert coils as first step, second step, to find the correct views to follow the flow diverter release from the right A2 to the left A1, avoiding the separate position of the coils. Well, we started with inserting the coils, and this was the position of the biplane. And really, in this position, we could get the lesions without any problems and put some coils inside them. Well, after that, we selected with rotational angiography, we selected the view for the H segment where we had planned to insert the first part of the flow diverter, right H2. This view is completely free from the superimposition of the coils. Then we selected this view for the left A1 segment, nicely shown. Well, after that, looking at not the subtractive images, we noticed something wrong. Well, the tail of the coil inserted into the smallest aneurysm was free in vessel. It didn't look in the same position as we had left it. And this was confirmed injecting some contrast medium into the carotid artery. Well, we release the first part of the stent. It was a silk vista in this case. And so we stuck the free part of the coil to the vessel wall without any complication for the flow inside it. Then we went on with the release of the second part of the stent into the left A1. And this is the stent during the procedure. And so we verified in the final angiographic study that everything in the intracranial circulation was normal, both of anterior cerebral arteries were good. So let's move to the third case. It's a ruptured aneurysm of the posterior communicating artery in a female, 73 years old, suffering from progressive impairments in memory and disturbances of balance. She had a severe sudden headache with blurred vision on her left eye a few days before the admission to the hospital, where she underwent a CT and MRI, where we found a large supracellular aneurysm. Then the patient underwent four vessel angiography, and as collateral findings, we saw a fenestration of the P1 left segment and also a macroaneurysm in M1, M2 region of the right side. Then injecting the left internal carotid artery, we saw the aneurysm with a regular shape and with a spontaneous filling of the posterior communicating artery of the left posterior cerebral artery. Well, we did also rotational, and we saw clearly the neck of the aneurysm was quite large. There was a bleb on the wall of the lesion, and we could also demonstrate that PCAM came from the body of the aneurysm, from the sac, directly from the sac of the aneurysm. So, problems. The size of the aneurysm, the size of its neck, and the diameter of the parent vessel, we knew that we needed to put a flow diverter starting from middle cerebral artery, ending to the internal carotid, and to put some coils inside the lesion, but there was a high risk of a sudden occlusion of PCAM. So we wondered if the fenestrated left P1 segment was adequate to support all the flow in the posterior cerebral artery, avoiding the large infarct in its territory. And we wondered also how to spare, or if it was possible to spare the PCAM. Well, we tried to save the origin of the PCAM, and the MCA was reached after the delivering of some loops of a microframe coil into the aneurysm because of the geometry of the carotid, the internal suprasellar carotid, and because of the inflow of the position, because of the position of the inflow to the aneurysm. Well, from the middle cerebral, we released the stent, the flow diverter. It was a thread this time. And then we inserted the entire coil into the lesion, looking carefully to the origin of PCAM. Here is the profile of the coil mesh inside the lesion. And it seemed a good position, because the origin of the PCAM was free. So we detached the coil, and this was the final result with the flow preserved into PCAM and to the posterior cerebral artery, with a stagnation of contrast medium inside the lesion. Well, let's go with the last case, the case of vertebrobasilar ruptured aneurysm in male, 71 years, with a history of hypertension, diffuse atherosclerosis and heart disease, and with familiarity for subarachnoid hemorrhage. On plain CT, you can see the large amount of blood in the supracellular region with some blood into the lateral ventricles. On enhanced CT, you see the aneurysm with two vessels, the two vertebral arteries, the basilar and the aneurysm in the reconstructed CT image. Patient underwent the angiographic examination and injecting the right subclavian artery. We saw obviously the aneurysm, but we noticed also that there was a spontaneous filling of the distal vertebral, left vertebral artery. And this was because there was a tight stenosis at the origin of the left vertebral. So the problems, how to get a good complete visualization of the aneurysm when they leave the left vertebral stenosis? Well, we decided to go with the aneurysm first. So for a good aneurysm visualization, we inserted a small microcatheter in through passing through the stenosis into the vertebral artery, left vertebral artery. We reached the distal part of the vessel and injecting some contrast medium from there, we had a good visualization of the basilar artery. Well, then we inserted a guiding catheter, 5 French guiding catheter into the right vertebral artery, 5 French because of the size and also large of the vertebral. Well, after that, injecting simultaneously both of the arteries, we had a good visualization of all the posterior circulation of the aneurysm. We did also in this way a rotational angiography with good quality images. And well, we went on for stent gelling technique. And we decided to go through the right vertebral for the flow diverter, through the left side for coils. And so we did. And in the roadmap image, you can see the flow diverter, again silk in this case, released from the middle of basilar artery to the distal right vertebral artery. You see also the tip of the microcatheter through which we insert the coils into the aneurysm with this final result at intracranial level. Then went back to the left vertebral stenosis. We redilated it and we inserted the stent with a restoring on the lumen vessel of the flow inside it. Well, this was my last case, and I thank you very much for your kind attention, and I give back the word to Dr. Gonzalez.
Thank you very much, Dr. Caputo. They have been very interesting cases and very illustrative ones. I am sure there's going to be a very lively discussion afterwards. Now we are going with Professor Adnan Siddiqui. Professor Siddiqui, he's a neurosurgeon. He's a professor and vice chairman of the Department of Neurosurgery at the State University of New York at Buffalo Jacobs School of Medicine and Biomedical Sciences. He completed his fellowship training in interventional neuroradiology, cerebrovascular surgery, and neurocritical care, and has a special interest and expertise in the performance of complementary microsurgical, radiosurgical, and endovascular techniques for cerebrovascular conditions. So he's an all-around performer. He can speak about all aspects of treatment of vascular diseases. His special area of interest is in the vascular management of acute ischemic stroke, but he has also broad experience in aneurysms, AVMs, whatever you like. He has over 450 peer-reviewed publications, He serves on multiple scientific and educational committees, and he leads the Canon Stroke and Vascular Research Center at the University of Buffalo. He's also the director of the Neurosurgical Stroke Service at the Gates Vascular Institute of Buffalo. I have been lucky enough to attend several presentations by Professor Siddiqui that have always been of outstanding quality. So it is indeed a great pleasure for me to be here presenting him. So Professor Siddiqui, Adnan, whenever you want.
Thank you very much, Andres. I really appreciate the very warm welcome. And so the charge today is to talk to you a little bit about what we call high-def imaging or high-definition imaging. And so it's relevant to me because neurosurgery started off by surgeons doing operations, including complicated operations with loops. Now, we then migrated to the operating microscope, and you can imagine this is the kind of detail we see under an operating microscope. You can see multiple cases of aneurysms, there's atherosclerosis, the angulation, the detail, the perforators, the branch points. These are all being visualized because of the microscope. So while it's really that effective in open surgery, why would we not do that in endovascular? And so that was the task that we, my mentor, Dr. Nick Hopkins, actually reached out to his partner and who was a physicist and X-ray specialist and engineer, Dr. Steve Rudin, to say, hey, can we get X-rays to do better than what where we are right now? Could it improve device or anatomic visualization, improving safety of procedures? And so he came up. So this is one of those original prototypes. Here it is mounted to an actual C-arm where you can see this is the original device that he came up with. So this is a microcatheter, and you can see the coil wind within it of the microcatheter, and these are coils being delivered. And he was able to bring this down to 35 micron resolution where you could actually see the difference between one pipeline inside another pipeline. So that was the kind of resolution you're getting. And so from that original study that we did in humans, the prototype that we have commercially available gives us about 70 micron resolution pixels, which is now available for clinical commercial use. And that's what I want to share with you is the value of this system is that there's a smooth transition between the standard flat panel detector down to high def with standard FOVs compared to the new high def zooms. And really it's just a touch of a button as you mag up or down to zoom in from one or the other. So this is an example. This is obviously a phantom, but there you can see two braided devices, and under conventional flat panel versus high def, you can see the kind of detail that you get. So this is a standard flat panel detection of lateral fluoro, and this kind of shows you as we go from 10, from 12 to 10 to 8 to 6 inches. And that's the end of flat panel, and this is where we go into a 3-inch and then 2.3-inch. And then this is what's currently available, a 1.5 inch. So you can imagine the kind of detail one can arrive where you are seeing the platinum wires, but you're literally even seeing the chromium cobalt in there. And you can see the compression of the device in here and a little bit more maybe relaxing out here and out here. So it really allows you to visualize the device like never before. So the question then became, well, what happens to the radiation dose? That was the first thing. You must be radiating them. So the point is that when you have the integral patient dose based on the KAP value, it's a lot lower because of the much smaller volume which is being irradiated. And so it really is the best example for this is that it is a high resolution X-ray microscope just like the one I have in the operating room. And this really can make it quite unique where you have pixel size compared to a flat panel of 194 down to a 75 micron resolution. That gives you a lot more detail that you would not be able to otherwise garner. And so, and the radiation dose becomes a lot better based on the fact that you're going for a much, much, much smaller area than you would otherwise. So here's some case examples that I'd like to share with you guys. is a 31-year-old with family history of subarachnoid and has a 5-millimeter aneurysm. You can see it's a dissecting aneurysm. She comes in with a new 6-nerve palsy, and there is the standard FOV. You can see these are video clips, not still shots, and this is under high def. So we'll go back and show you. This was under standard flat panel detection. And now under high def, you can see that there's, and this is not like a digital zoom. This is truly, even the perforators, the inferolateral trunk complex that you're starting to see is really quite incredible in terms of the detail that you can see. And now you can see that we are up there with a ready to deliver a flow diverter. And this is the flow diverter being deployed. So there you can see it's being pinched. There's the distal capture coil. There's the distal wire. You can see the little connections in here. You can see the central wire going through it. You can see compression, expansion. So this is an actual case where you can see this kind of detail with all those tines as the procedure is being done. So this is something that we had never seen before. And then what you can do is you can do cone beam CT to look at apposition, but look at the kind of apposition you get under high def, where you can very nicely see the device is fully opposed in the region proximal. Obviously, it's not in the region of the aneurysm, and it's fully opposed distally as well. So I think that is really quite tremendous. This is, again, standard flat panel detection at the end. Here's another case, 38-year-old, multiple IC aneurysms. And again, you can see there's an aneurysm farm here. This is standard flat panel detection and has that prior craniotomy. And there, this is, by the way, it's being done awake. The patient actually coughed while we were delivering there. You can see the head opening up. But again, this is the device being delivered and the kind of detail you can see with each angle, with each point, you can see what's happening. Is it flat? There's a wire. And again, you're saying, okay, we need to straighten out the energy. There's too much energy here. Let's release it. And then we'll try to straighten it out. There you can see trying to straighten this window out. And this is always a challenge with flow diverters. But okay, how do we open it up? Now you can see we've opened it, but there's a little bit of a waste here. Okay, that is going to be unacceptable. So there is bringing a larger catheter to see if that opens it up. It's still not good enough. So we need to do something else. So you want to make sure you leave. There you go. Now we just release that tension. So let's look at that again. So we are trying to open it up. There's the flex intermediate catheter. There's the microcatheter. And you're pushing the whole device. You're pushing it forward to really get that energy out there. You can see the proximal end is open and there it just foreshortened. And that's how you confirm that you have good visualization. Again, same thing here. You are making sure that the visualization is excellent in the regions of the aneurysm, particularly proximal. And that you can see the great stasis that is created by the distal carotid aneurysms. And there's the final result as well. So that's the kind of detail that one can get with standard procedures. Here's a 30-year-old, another presenter with the worst headache for life. However, no subarachnoid. So this is somebody we brought to the cath lab, and it's got an interesting, quite robust inferior apophyseal artery with blush in the posterior. You looked at it twice and thrice to say, hey, is there something special going on? But no, this is just a standard paraclinoid aneurysm. Again, this is the FRED that we just saw Dr. Caputo show. But look at how much better you see this. This is the 2.3-inch. So there you can see the device. Every single platinum wire is very, very nicely seen. And it's being delivered. There's a microcatheter that's been jailed. And you can really make sure the device is open. In fact, this is compressed imaging, But if you're seeing it under real fluoro, you are able to actually see the nitinol threads that are here as well, not just the platinum wires, but the nitinol ones are also seen in under x-ray. And again, you're making sure you open it up. We release it, and then we'll make sure that we release the distal tension. And once we have it there you can see it's still angled and it's elongated in the distal part. So that is something that needs to be addressed. So again, you can see this is a coil that's just going outside, visualized very clearly, and therefore you reposition and you continue to coil till the cows come home, till we're really comfortable. And once we have done that, then we can really make sure that we have completely pushed the stent. And there you can see the thread has been pushed up into the proximal horizontal segment. So it no longer is elongated and the vessel wall alignment is much better. Now, part of what you still can't see perfectly here are the nitinol rings in terms of apposition. That's where pipeline visualization is a little bit better, but I think that still makes quite a difference. And this is our standard views of the same exact case, and it really shows you how much better you can see under the higher magnification. Here's a 56-year-old, multiple aneurysms, and again, multiple flow diverters. This really becomes really tricky when you're doing these cases, but here, you can see very nicely this device. You can see very nicely this is now compressed. You can see very nicely the distal wire, the central wire, the distal capture. You can see detachment zone, and you can really appreciate the device behavior as it's being deployed to make sure that device behavior is optimal. There it's being compressed again to make sure we're good, and then device is released. And this is how we then extend the device to fully cover and compress in regions where you want. And you can see it's not just true for lateral, but AP, both planes are very good. And this is the sort of detail that one can get after deployment of the device. And now an extension is being applied with a second device to the more to cover the more proximal cavernous aneurysm. And there we go, there is release. And you can actually see very nicely where the release is. And then we actually, you can see it just jumped up. Want to make sure that we have good wall apposition, but it doesn't necessarily mean there you can see the compression right there. And so that's now optimally shortened off on both planes to confirm that we are in a good position. And there is again, with contrast imaging, you can see very nicely wall apposition here, although there's some lack out here. And then again, dealer's choice, it really allows us to plasty. And this is sort of an idea as to how many cases we have done, you know, a standard IR versus high def. And you can imagine that when you look at the number of cases which went over one gray were 80% versus 12% with the high def. And it's just better visualization results in a shorter, faster procedure, even though the pulse might be larger, but the area is restricted enough that overall the product is something which is a more refined, better compared to, you can see even just these footprints of the actual exposure. You can see the high def dose is a lot lower. This is a couple of other cases, and then we'll sort of stop. This is 64-year-old who presents with double vision, six nerve palsy. There it is, ugly aneurysm. You can see 3D imaging showing you the entire segment is dysplastic, but it's ideal for flow diversion. And we do a balloon test occlusion in these ugly cases to make sure that the patient will tolerate it. And once we know we're good, then we get dual access, one with a 5 French, the system for coiling, the other with a 6 French. And there you can see we're going across with the microcatheter to get into distal circulation. And then we are jailing a microcatheter as was shown by Dr. Caputo as well in one of our cases. And once we have a microcatheter gelled, then we are going to deploy the flow diverter very slowly. I don't want to gel the A1, so it's going to be just proximal to the A1. But again, the kind of imaging visualization that one is seeing with this is quite spectacular in terms of exactly what you're opening where and how you're going to get through. And I like to do the flow diverter part first, because this then allows you to go ahead and coil. So here come the coils now, once we know that we have completely covered the aneurysm and it's well covered. And once we've done that, now you can see there's that jet that's still going in. So this requires coils. That makes the situation much more secure and much less risky. Again, the patient's being done awake and just put lots and lots and lots of coils. And this is literally, there's a plasty right there because we feel that there may be a little lack of connectivity. So then there's a transform balloon which is brought up, and there you can see the plasty to make sure we get the really ideal visual. And there's the final results, 18 lab reviews. Here next week. So when we look at this, is I believe another case. Radial sheath, a fusiform IC aneurysm. This is another one we'll be getting access. Again, ugly fusiform aneurysm. And when we have this straightforward, trying to make sure that we can get through to the other side. Prior to flow diversion, this was really challenging. With flow diversion, it's really straightforward. The key thing is to make sure that we get through the prior stents. And this is the beauty of being able to visualize the prior stents. So once we have this place, this is now the evolved stent, which is being played through the previously placed Elvises. And there come the delivery system. Again, visualization is key in making sure you're inside the lumen, you're not outside. Once you have this in place, then you start delivering the device. And we'll show you exactly how the device delivers as well. It's making sure that we have distal access. And once we have deployed the whole thing, then we are very happy with it. And we make sure we oppose the whole thing. So here I'm going to start showing again how the device is being deployed all the way. You can see the entire outline of the device. And there we have good wall apposition. So that sort of wanted to show the visualization ability. This is a more straightforward case. It's a basilar aneurysm, standard stent coil, nothing too fancy with a transradial approach. And there is the stent, which is ready to come out. And now we're getting ready to go into the microcatheter. We usually like to have a coil in the aneurysm before I start putting a stent. There comes my stent being deployed. Again, you can see there's a device being deployed. Even this Atlas stent, you can sort of see the lines on here, and under regular fluoro, it's much better seen than it is right now. And once we see this, once we start putting coils, we then just continue to put coils till we're happy. And this is sort of the final result. And that is quite adequate. Another case example is a web. Again, 5 millimeter web. These can be quite challenging in terms of how to see. So I'm going to go straight to the key part of deploying a web. There is the aneurysm right there. And so now we're going to go up with under standard magnification. And once we are there, now this is under higher def magnification, and you can start seeing the device being deployed. You know what its interaction is. There's the bleb. That's the one you want to avoid. And once we have that much open, then you are actually, as you're pushing the device, you're unsheathing the microcatheter. There you can see the hands as to what's happening. And you can see it starting to form its shape. And as it forms its shape, then you actually relax a little bit on the pulling and do a little bit more of the pushing. to get that last little bit out. And there, it just popped out, the shoulders popped out. It looks really good. And once you've done this, then what you want to do is do a little bit of fluoro. And there we go. You will see the fluoro. There we go. So that under high def, this is again high def, really shows very, very nicely, very good positioning for the case. Again, high def showing excellent positioning, excellent occlusion of the aneurysm. And that's exactly what you're sort of looking for. And this is the last picture here that shows you right there. This is the kind of visualization you get for a web in the skull. This is through the skull base, you know, through the nasal bones. This is the lateral view, which is slightly less crowded in this instance, but it really allows you to see the details of the actual device, the detachment zone, the pinched area. That is quite spectacular. And really, I don't think we've seen it with anything else. Here's a pseudotumor case of venous hypertension. And again, this is standard fluoro. We know where we are. And then when we, this is under high def, and then just look at how beautifully you can see the stentines and the segment, and we start opening it. We are going to now show how nicely it starts opening. And that really makes a huge difference in terms of deployment technique. So there it is. So there's too much pressure being applied forward. So we're pushing it. I don't think we need to do that. So we can actually see, no, relax the hand a little bit. And now it's being delivered much more nicely. There's no reason to compress and the whole stent and every single time can be very nicely seen. And once we have done that, we can do a run and show, we can do some measurements. And then we'll typically do a run and then close up. So I think at this point, this might be a common Nietzsche case. I have lots and lots of cases. There's a stenosis there. And so this is a stent being deployed in the vertebral ostium. There you can somewhat concerned that there may be a little overhang. So this is called a flash ostial balloon, which we inflate the balloon and then we use this flash ostial to really open it up. So we do that first and then we see there's the aneurysm, then we cath the aneurysm. Again, high def, we confirm we get access distally for making sure that we have access for an aneurysm stent. And then we start coiling because we are concerned, otherwise coil will occlude. And now the atlas being deployed just perfectly. So it's sitting right at the ostium right there. And now we can go ahead and coil the aneurysm very securely to make sure that it's well treated without any issues and pack the coils. And this is the final result, which looks quite excellent. So I think from my standpoint, I can just show cases over and over and over again with high def. But I think at this point, I'll stop take any questions from the crew. Very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Siddiqui. It's been a very interesting presentation, as always. So the question by Edin Advagic is for Dr. Caputo. So the question is, have you made follow-up of the third case? Was the PCOM still open after that follow-up?
Well, the case has been done 3 months ago, so I don't have a follow-up, mm-hmm. but the patient is okay.
Okay.
So I thought that even if it would occlude the PCOM, mm-hmm. I mean, it will do it slowly because of the flow diverter effect. Mm-hmm. So in my opinion, it's less dangerous if I had occluded it immediately.
Okay.
This was my
That's your take now, okay?
And what I can say now is the patient is okay.
Okay, perfect. Okay, as long as the patient is okay, it doesn't really matter if the PCOM is open or not.
Okay.
I actually had a case very much like this in somebody who had true fetal PCOM. I could not even see a P1 on that side with a very large aneurysm. It had been previously clipped and coiled and had continued to recur. So I did a case which I called pelvis. So PED plus Elvis. Uh-huh. So what I did was I dropped the Elvis in the PCOM. So it was abutting the ICA and then deployed the pipeline in the ICA. And that stayed open and plus additional coils, you know, with the jail catheter. So it was very similar, but I actually put in a stent in that PCOM to make sure that it stayed open. And that did work.
Okay. That's a good idea. Yes. So I cannot see any more questions as of now. So I have a couple of questions for Dr. Caputo. Some of your cases were treated with a stent in an acute setting of subarachnoid hemorrhage. What is the anti-aggregation protocol you use in this kind of cases?
Oh, well, not before putting the stent, obviously, because it's not good, I think, to do that. But during delivery of the stent, I inject usually some aspirin, 1,000 milligrams. And then I put the patient for 24 hours under heparin, intravenous heparin. And after that, I leave it with the patient under double anti-aggregation, Plavix and aspirin.
And it is enough? There is no, you don't have problems with...
Up to now,
it's okay. Okay,
no,
good to know.
If it will yeah, but it's, yeah.
Okay, good. Even when using, flow diverters, when we use a stent in the acute setting, we do the same. We don't use any anti-aggregants until the last possible moment.
Yeah.
And then
we
also use IV aspirin, which is not available in every country, as you know. And then we use tirofiban, and we keep the patient under tirofiban for 24 hours, and then we shift to clopidogrel or ticagrelor or whatever we think the patient needs.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
What's your protocol in these cases, Anan?
So, again, I try my level best not to have to stent in the acute phase. Really. Balloon coil and sit and wait. But, you know, say I have a blister aneurysm. So there is nothing I'm going to do in that case. I'm not going to put coils, balloon. I'm going to do a flow diverter 100% of the time. What I do is... I do an angiogram. I make sure that I put an EVD in, a ventriculostomy in, then the next day treat the aneurysm. So I usually give 12 to 24 hours after EVD is in. And then I load the patient on the table with aspirin and Brilinta, either orally or through NG. And then I heparinize the patient and deploy the flow diverter. The only time I use integrin or 2B3A is if there's instant thrombosis. So I start seeing that cobblestone platelet aggregation occurring, then I'll give 2B3A, otherwise aspirin and Brilinta, no more Plavix. The Plavix resistance is almost 25-30%. Brilinta is a lot lower. And Prasugrel would be very good too, but unfortunately, in the U.S., there's a black box warning against Prasugrel, which makes it a little bit more complicated. So I use ticagrelor instead.
So this brings me to one question for you, Adnan, concerning the high definition feature of your biplane angiographer. In these cases, what's your experience detecting these small cobblestone images with the high definition features?
Yeah, so the best way of describing this is we have two rooms. You know, one is the high def room, the other standard def room. And so what has happened is that everybody wants to use the high def room for interventions. And so the standard definition room is now only used for diagnostics. So that gives you an idea as to the kind of information we are getting. And that's how we have the data of almost 400 cases in each arm is that we, you know, it's just, it's very uniquely informative that you, when you see that, you say, why would I, when you go and, you know, so an emergency comes in, you've got to do the case in the standard room, you realize, oh, I wish I was in the other room, you know, because you just, it's all we do, it has to do with what we see. The better we see, the better we are. And so absolutely, I will see that little cobblestone on that pipeline. I think I see it sooner now because of the better visualization.
Okay, okay. So Nevia, when you use the when you deploy the stent, do you perform flat panel CT prior to the deploying, prior to starting the anti-irrigation?
No, you don't. Not usually.
Not usually, okay.
Not always, no.
Do you do it, Adnan? Do you use flat panel?
Yes. So this is my routine. So I do flat panel after every stroke case to look for if there's any subarachnoid hemorrhage or contrast staining. So I always do that, and then I'll repeat another CT in 4, 6, 8 hours or sooner if I see subarachnoid. And then for all flow diversion cases, I always do that diluted contrast stent protocol cone beam CT. So I can really evaluate vessel wall imaging. I typically do not use it for coiling associated cases. I always use it for web cases. So, you know, it's because coiling creates too much of an artifact to provide useful information. But web and flow diverters, it's incredibly useful.
In our experience, we always use the flat panel CT just before deploying the stent and just before beginning with the tirofiban in order to detect a small subarachnoid hemorrhage that we have caused with a wire or whatever. But sometimes if your machine is not very good, you can have a false security. You can feel you are completely in the safe, and then you discover that you are really not. So it is really important to have a very good quality equipment to do this.
Agreed. Okay.
So there's a couple more questions that have come up. Carlos Lumillano is asking us, how long do we use Plavix after Plavix or whatever double anti-aggregation we want to use after a flow diverter or stenting? Nevia, what is your protocol?
Yes, my protocol is this. I use a double anti-aggregation for 1 month. Then I leave the patient for 2 more months under aspirin. And then after that, if the patient obviously hadn't taken the aspirin before the procedure, I will leave the patient free from anti-aggregation.
Even with flow diverters?
Yeah.
Okay, so good to know. It is much shorter than my usual protocol.
Yes, I know, but there are very, very way to...
Yeah, there are so many, yes.
Double anti-aggregation.
Yeah.
Up to now, it works.
Mediterranean diet in Italy is so good for this.
Olive oil. Unfortunately, I keep patients much longer. It depends on the aneurysms. So if it's a relatively small area that requires endothelialization, so a relatively smaller neck, paracline, 5, 8, 10 millimeters, I will do 6 months or dual antiplatelet, 6 months, and then aspirin for life. However, if it's a fusiform aneurysm, I will do 1 year or even longer, depending on how fusiform. So that paraclinoid aneurysm, I would typically do 6 months. That cavernous dissecting aneurysm would be at a minimum 1 year. Vertebrobasilar, atherosclerotic, those are going to be on dual antiplatelets for life.
Okay. So it seems like this kind of ischemic complications can have a very interesting difference between geographical locations, maybe related with diet or genetics or whatever it is.
Yes, I believe so.
More questions are coming up. Omar Helou, he wants to ask if that we used to put clips on large necked aneurysms, but here doctors put coils. So what are the guidelines for interventional radiology or clips? Do you have any protocol? Do you think it depends on the expertise of the every hospital? In this case, perhaps, Adnan, you are able to perform both interventions. When do you choose each kind of intervention?
It's a very good question, Omar. Absolutely. I love clipping aneurysms. I still do about 25, 30 bypasses, almost none for aneurysms. And so I have a very busy open vascular practice. That said, if an aneurysm can be treated through either methodology adequately, I choose endovascular. So the times that I select microsurgery is typically in the instance where there is a compression on a neural structure which is symptomatic. So somebody who presents with optic nerve compression with a visual field deficit or a third nerve, I think those are instances where surgical decompression is of value. The second instance in which I use clipping is if it's a relatively small aneurysm in a bifurcation setting where I'm afraid of using coils because of the angulation. I'm afraid I'm not going to be able to really secure this without with aggressive stenting, or I'll have to do Y stenting to try to treat it when microsurgically it's easy. So for instance, a perfect example is if you have the same exact aneurysm on the basilar terminus, I'll end up stent coiling that or Y stenting that. On the other hand, if it's the same exact aneurysm on an MCA bifurcation, I'm more likely to clip it because you know you weigh the pros and cons. When for an MCA, it's so easily accessible. It's a short, simple operation, no need for dual antiplatelets, overnight stay in the hospital, morbidity about 5%, that's better. That's not the case when you're clipping a basilar. That's a higher risk operation. There, dual antiplatelet with Y stenting makes sense. So it depends on location, it depends on shape, it's nuanced. But I do believe that the ideal circumstance is that the team that's taking care of vascular disease should have both members, either in the same person or multiple people, doesn't matter. But there should always be a dialogue.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. This has to be consensuated by the whole team.
Yes.
And the same Dr. Omar El-Helou asks, in case when there is a still continuous feeding of the aneurysm after coiling, I presume, do you consider recoiling or clipping?
So again, from my standpoint, once you have clipped an aneurysm, you've done a craniotomy, going back and re-clipping it is a very high-risk procedure because of the adhesions that form after the first operation. So just removing the bone flap and opening the dura can result in significant decorticalization injury because of the adhesions that happen after the first one. So if you get a recurrence after clipping, you're best trying to do an endovascular solution. However, if you get a recurrence after endovascular, you can clip that, or you can try additional endovasculars. There's no problem with that. So again, it depends. There's no hard or fast rule for one approach or the other. You've always got to think of all the different ways and then try to come up with the right solution for that particular patient.
Is this also your experience, Dr. Caputo?
Yes, absolutely, yes. I don't operate on, obviously. So I'm not certain.
But you always see the cases with your neurosurgeon, I presume?
Yes.
And you decide which is the best case.
Possible not to do that.
Of course, because then if you have a complication or whatever.
Absolutely.
You need everyone to be on the same page. Okay, I have one last question for Professor Siddiqui. With the kind of resolution that you are obtaining now, and you saw with the high def, do you see any? Are you able to see the struts of the stent drivers when you perform stroke interventions. And do you think that is interesting in order to be able to detect, for example, an intracranial stenosis during stroke treatment? Or do you think it is, we are still far from that definition now?
Great question. So it depends on the stent retriever. So if you're using a Trevo, you will see where it is not opposed. And then you've got to determine, is that being pushed by a clot or by ICAD? You know, you can't tell because it's there. But I believe that being able to visualize a device or, you know, the Tiger Retriever, when you open it up with the Rapid, you can kind of see how it opens eccentrically. That can give you an idea as to where the thrombus is. And when you pull it back, you can actually appreciate that. So what I do typically is that when I'm doing a stroke now, I'll start off with the standard AP lateral view at 8 inches so you can get the whole head. And then I'll go under standard, you know, like a 6 inch to cross the lesion. And when I'm pulling, then I go under high def. I go into 2.3 or 3 inch so I can actually see the device and see it's opening or closing. I can't differentiate ICAT from clot, but I can see where the clot is.
Okay, very interesting. Okay, I can see no more questions from the audience. I don't have any more from my own. Does anybody else want to say anything? Any questions from either Dr. Caputo or Professor Siddiqui?
Thank you.
No. It was my pleasure to join you, Dr. Caputo and Dr. Manley. Wonderful. Really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Gonzalez-Mandley, for being such a wonderful host for that fantastic session. And thanks again both to Dr. Caputo and Professor Siddiqui for those really excellent presentations and that great discussion at the end. It really was fascinating, and I can't wait to see where interventional neuroradiology will take us next. So that concludes our 3 days of stroke sessions. Thank you all for joining us this evening, and I hope to see you next week.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Bye.